Again, we want to turn in our Bibles to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 6. And we have been going through the book of Hebrews. And last week when we were together, we were talking about, is it possible to go too far? And what did we find? Is it possible?
Yes.
Amen. We found that it is possible. Now, we don't say that delightfully, but we do know that it is possible. And we saw that God has an object for us. And what is that object? What is God's object for us? To save us. And not just to save us. Amen. But as he prayed in John 17, Father, I will that they be with me where I am. And that was his prayer, that we would be with him. And where is Christ? He's in heaven. And that's where he wants us. He tells us in John 14 that he has gone to do what? Prepare a place for us. And if he has went to prepare a place, he will do what? Return again and receive us unto himself, that where he is, there we may be also. That is God's object for us. But that object, we are told, we are defeating. Why? Because the light that is being shed upon our pathway, we're not walking in it. We're making decisions based off what we think. We're making decisions based off how we feel, and we're not making decisions that is in harmony with the Word of God. Now, in times of our ignorance, God has winked at, but now as light has come, God commandeth men everywhere to repent. So as light shines, as God gives us more light, it is with the intent that we would walk in it. And so as we reject that light, we're defeating the object for which God gave us that light. And that light will turn into darkness. And so what happens is, when we think about going too far with God, is something that we cannot really fathom, because we are told in Steps of Christ that as long as we have known, or long as that we have had a conscience, we have been the subjects of grace. Ever since we've come into this world, even though we were born in sin and we were trained, shapen in iniquity, we have been the subjects of grace because of what Christ did on the cross, the plan that he had devised from the foundation of the world. We have always been the subjects of grace. So it is something that we cannot even really contemplate ever being without it. But God has given us in his word examples of individuals who have pressed beyond the boundaries that God have set. We saw in Cain that Jesus came to Cain and sought to recover him from the condition or the position that Satan was pushing him in. But he cast off the love of God. He cast off the presence of God, and he went out, the Bible says, from God's presence. He ran away, as it were, from God, and his seed is what brought about the flood. We found the same thing with Esau, how Esau was purposed because of his birth to have the birthright. But we realize that he despised the birthright. He had no desire for the spiritual blessing of being the high priest. He did not care for the religious aspect of his father's training. And we see that he ran out. But when the birthright was about to be taken, the Bible says he pleaded, he sought for it with tears, but he could not find a place of repentance, though he sought it carefully. We saw how Judas, we were talking about in Sabbath school this morning, how Christ said to him, "What thou doest, do quickly." And Judas turned from the light and went into outer darkness. And then we find and we see at the end of time in Revelation chapter 6, we didn't talk about it, but in Revelation chapter 6, we see that under that sixth seal, and we're living under the sixth seal, but under that sixth seal, when Jesus, when the way is being made, when the kings of the east, or the king of the east, Jesus, is seen coming, and under the sixth seal, we find that there will be men and women, boys and girls, rich men and mighty men, chief captains, slaves, free men, bondmen, running to the rocks and to the mountains, desiring to be hid from the face of him that sitteth upon the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. So as they see these things, they are going to run from a Lamb that purposed to save them. So we do see in the Bible that it is possible for us to go beyond God's saving grace. Hard to fathom, but brothers and sisters, it is possible to sin away the Spirit of God, to break up, to make our minds so hardened that we do not recognize God's presence anymore. Let's look quickly. Romans 1. We're coming back to Hebrews 6. But notice what your Bible says in Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. Notice what the Bible says in Romans chapter 1. Now, we must not believe that just because an individual has or lives a particular lifestyle, that is any way an indication that that person has gone too far. We are not the detectors to tell a person that they have gone too far. As a matter of fact, we would look at those demoniacs and we would say that those individuals, they've gone too far with their dreadlocks and their unclothed bodies, living in the graves, among the tombs, the Bible says, cutting themselves with no clothes. We would say these individuals have gone too far. But we see that salvation came to them. And one accepted the gift of salvation. Whereas we would look at the Pharisees who sat in Moses' seat, but not realizing that they had gone too far. When Caiaphas rent his robe, probation closed upon him. And yet he continued to minister in the sacred office. But he was cast out, as it were, an abominable branch, and probation had closed upon him. And so again, we cannot look on the outward and determine whether or not a person has gone too far. That is for God to know. But we must show from the Word of God that it is possible. Notice what it says. Romans chapter 1, looking at verse 25. Romans 1, verse 25.
Linda Williams.
Notice what
has arrived.
Notice what the Bible says. It says, verse 22 says, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God, verse 23, into the image made like to corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to what? God gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the what? Creature more than the who was blessed forever. Amen. For this cause, now watch this, for this cause God gave them what? Up unto vile affection. So in other words, God simply gave them over to that which they desired. Now, if you're listening, if you could put your phone on mute. The Bible says, for this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their what? Women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the women, burned in their lust one towards another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, receiving in themselves the recompense of their error, which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in there, God gave them what? Over to a what? Reprobate. Now, what is reprobate?
Depraved.
Something that cannot even reason anymore. And why? God gave them up because they constantly went against nature. those things which can be naturally seen, they constantly pushed against it, and God simply gave them up to that which they longed for and that which they desired. And it says here that he gave them up to a reprobate mind, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, verse 32, who what? Knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. Now, these, again, individuals who recognize that this is against God, but continue to push in this direction. And God gives them up to a reprobate mind. God gives them up to that which they themselves have longed for and desire. Could it be that as we look around this world and as we see vice on every hand, could it be that God is simply giving people up to their own desires? Could it be that God is saying, this is what you're wanting, then you can have it. And this is what we do see in society. But unlike the polls, there are still those who are open for truth and longing for guidance. Regardless, again, of what Hollywood says, there's still someone that is still open and desiring to give their hearts to Christ. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews. As a matter of fact, we'll start in chapter 5. We'll start in chapter 5 and we'll move into chapter 6. Now, again, last week, our emphasis was, can man go too far? We saw that was yes. But we want to understand now, as we begin to consider Christ, our high priest, as we begin to look at his ministry, we saw that in Hebrews chapter 5, it talked about Aaron. And it talked about how Aaron was called of God. And this was not something that he chose for himself, but it was something that God called him into. And then it tells us in Hebrews 5, it is going to start comparing Christ to Aaron. Like we said, when you look at the book of Hebrews, from chapter 1 all the way to the end, God is showing, he's comparing that which the Hebrews are accustomed to, but he's always offering them something what? Better. They think about, he says, look at Adam, but there was someone better. Here is Moses, but there's someone better. He says, here is Christ, or the priestly ministry of Aaron, but there's something better. And that something better is Jesus. Now, again, Paul is using language that the Hebrews would understand. But at the same time, the language that he's using is considered by the Jews to be blasphemy. In other words, he's not just sitting around having a nice conversation with the Jews. He is literally showing that which they're trusting in is worthless in the sight of God. And this is why you see in the book of Galatians where he says there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither male nor female. Now, he's not trying to just do away with the order that God has set. But what he is trying to do is show that their preeminence is not even considered when it comes to the gospel. Yes, it was needful that the gospel first been sent to you, but lo, you have proved yourselves unworthy. God has turned to the Gentiles. And there are those now in the Gentiles whom God is using and causing to lead out, where there are Jews who are now having to take a back seat because they don't understand the gospel. And the same thing is happening in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But let's follow the point. So here in Rome, Hebrews chapter 5, beginning at verse 5, we already looked down to verse 4, and we're coming down to verse 5, and the Bible says, so also what? Christ. Or not what, who. So also Christ glorified not himself to be made a what? High priest. Let's stop for a moment. Let's suppose that someone does not understand what an high priest is. Let's just suppose that someone doesn't understand. The high priest is the priest whom God has placed in a position to be minister over all the priests in the realm. Now, priests were ministers. Hold your finger and go to the book of Malachi chapter 2. Let's go in our Bibles to the book of Malachi chapter 2. If you have a marker, keep it there. Let's go to Malachi chapter 2. Notice what the Bible says in Malachi chapter 2, and we want to look at verse 7. Malachi chapter 2, beginning at verse 7. When you have it, amen.
Amen.
All right. Matter of fact, I'm going to start in verse 6. And we're going to read down to verse 7. So here it says, Malachi chapter 2, verse 6 and 7. The Bible says, the law of truth was in his mouth. The law of truth was in his mouth, and iniquity was not found in his lips. He walked with me in peace and equity, and it turned many away from iniquity. Verse 7. For the what? Priest's lips should keep what? Knowledge, and they should seek the law at his mouth, for he is the messenger of the Lord of hosts. So when we look at the priest was simply to be God's messenger, and they were simply to lead God's people in the way of truth. Are we together? So here the Bible tells us that when we look at these priests in the Old Testament, he tells us in 1 Peter. Go to 1 Peter chapter 2. Notice what it says in 1 Peter chapter 2. First Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. First Peter chapter 2, looking at verse 9. The Bible says, First Peter chapter 2, verse 9 says, but ye are a chosen generation, a what?
Royal priesthood.
Now, a royal what?
Priesthood.
Royal priesthood. If you have a marginal reference, if not, just write down Exodus 19, verses 5 to verse 7. But in Exodus 19, 5 to 7, Moses, or God, speaks to the children of Israel, and he says that you shall be called a kingdom of priests. A kingdom of priests. You are a royal priesthood. So when God is looking at the church were to be the ministers or the messengers of God to the world. Are we together? That's what they were to be. They were to minister to God's people. They were to be messengers for the people of God. And so as priests in the Old Testament, you have ministers, messengers in the New Testament. Are we together? So we don't necessarily have a priesthood in the sense of saying high priest, but we have ministers, messengers that were to keep or to have within their lips the law of what? The law of truth. They were to turn many from what? Iniquity. Is that not what God has called us to do? To turn many from iniquity? We are to be the messengers of God. We are to hear the law at his mouth. We are to have the law of truth upon our lips. So Christ, as a messenger, as a priest of the sanctuary which is in heaven, we upon earth are to be his priests or his ministers or messengers of righteousness. Are we still together? Let's go in our Bibles. Let's go back to Hebrews. Let's look here at Hebrews chapter 5. Again, Hebrews chapter 5, looking at verse 5. So Jesus is the high priest in the sanctuary of which the Bible is eventually going to lead us into when we get to chapter 8. He's going to show us what Christ is a priest over. Because when Jesus was on earth, he was not a priest. He was not a priest. Paul says that if he was on earth, he would not have been a priest. Therefore, he had to go to heaven. Because Jesus sprang out of what tribe? The tribe of Judah, of which Paul says nothing concerning the priesthood is spoken. Remember Uzzah, not Uzzah, pardon me, Uzziah. And King Uzziah was the king in 2 Chronicles chapter 26 that went into the sanctuary and tried to offer up sacrifice. And the priest came and said, "What are you doing?" And he became prideful and still persisted to offer, and leprosy sprang up on his forehead. And the minister and the priest pushed him out of the sanctuary. Well, guess what? Uzzah was from the tribe of Judah. Or Uzziah, pardon me, not Uzzah. Uzziah was from the tribe of Judah. So that is an example that shows us that among the tribe of Judah, there were no priests. That was not their order. They were to be kings, yes. They were the lawgiver, yes, but they were not to be priests. So Jesus on earth, according to the lineage of the tribe he came out of, he was not ordained on earth to be a priest. Amen. Are we together? Notice what it says. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 5. The Bible says, "So also Christ glorified not himself to be made a high priest, but he that said unto him, Thou art my, today have I begotten thee." What is this speaking of? His birth or his resurrection? Resurrection. His resurrection, not his birth. It says, "But he that saith unto him, Thou art my son, today have I begotten thee," verse 6, as he saith also in another place, "Thou art a forever after the order of." So now, there are two things that are spoken here. It says, "Thou art my son, today have I begotten thee," speaking of the resurrection, not his birth. And then he says, said also in another place, "Thou art what? A priest forever after the order of Melchisedec." So here we have two things that gives Christ the right to be priest. And what is it? Talk to me now. Say it, Nathaniel.
He was begotten.
Okay, he was begotten. But there's something that that's designating him as priest.
The order of Melchisedec. He was ordained.
Okay, he was ordained, but right here in this scripture, what does it say?
Verse 6.
As he won, saith also in another place, what?
Thou art a priest forever
after. Okay, so what is designating him? I think someone said it, but I kind of brushed over it.
The priest after the order of Melchisedec.
He was ordained and he was appointed already to be a priest.
All right. You're passing over it. He's called. In other words, you're right. He's called by God. But I was looking for specifically the word of God. God's word is what designates him as a priest. In other words, he is not brought into the priesthood after various carnal commandments, but is the word of God that is designating him as priest. Because as we move forward, you're going to see that when it comes to the lineage of Judah, he's not a priest. Because if he comes from the tribe of Judah, there's nothing that makes him priest. But the mere fact that God calls him a priest, he now is the priest. God's word designated him as being the priest. Now watch this. Let's keep moving. We're going to see this more as we move forward. Notice what it says in verse 7. who in the days, this is Christ, who in the days of his flesh while he was upon the earth, when he had offered up prayers and supplication with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared. Though he were a son, yet learned he what? Obedience by the things which he suffered, and being made, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Verse 10, what's that next word? Called of God, a what? After the what? Melchisedec. Now, jump back to verse 4. And no man what? Taketh this honor unto himself, but he that is, as was. Verse 5, so also, stop for a moment. So also Christ. Christ did not make himself priest. Who made him priest? God the Father. Are we together? So God made Christ our high priest. But he called him not after the order of Aaron, but after the order of Melchisedec. Now, what's interesting is when we start to, now that Paul inserts Melchisedec here, he is about to do something to the priestly or to the priestly ministry of Aaron. Because in the Jews' sight, when it come to the high priestly order of Aaron, it meant everything to them. We're coming back here. Go in your Bibles to the book of Ezra, chapter 2. Go to Ezra, chapter 2. Ezra, chapter 2. I'm in the wrong place. Ezra, the second chapter, and we want to look at verse 60. I'll start in verse 61 down to 62. Notice what the Bible says in Ezra chapter 2, 61 and 62. The priesthood of Aaron meant everything, brothers and sisters, to the children of Israel. When it came to the ministry, when it came to ministry. And so this is why it shows us, even in this, in the days in which we're living, we are not made ministers after the carnal order of man, but we are called of God. Ezra chapter 2, verse 61 and 62. Now, again, I'm emphasizing that point for a moment because we have to understand something, is that we recognize that Aaron did not desire this title. He was called of God. God made him priest. And so when it comes down to Christ, though he was not of the order of Aaron, yet he was called of God. And this was something that the Jews could not understand even while Christ walked around on the earth. They came to John the Baptist and said, wait a minute, who gave you the authority to do what you're doing? Jesus and John said, he that sent me to baptize. He that sent me into the wilderness. This is the same one that gave me the authority. Amen. They came to Jesus. Who gave you this authority? Well, let me ask you a question. Well, I don't know. Well, guess what? I can't tell you either. So the thing is, even when it came down to the priest, it came down to the disciples, they said, listen, you better not speak this man's name again. They said, hey, whether it be right in your sight, we'll let you deal with that. But we will not but speak the things that we have seen and heard. It is better for us to obey God rather than man. Why? Because we were not called of man, we were called of God. So in this latter day, We are called to the ministry, not by man, but by God. Amen. And we are told in great controversy that God is going to put people into the work who have been trained by his spirit rather than by literary institutes. Amen. They will be called of God. And today, people cannot accept your ministry except you come through the line of Aaron, so to speak. It meant everything to the Jew to come through the line of Aaron. But Christ, that Paul is showing them that there's a greater line than that of Aaron. Amen. Notice what it says in Ezra chapter 2 and verse 61. It says, and of the children of the priest. You're there? Ezra 2 and 61. It says, and of the children of the priest, the children of Habiah, the children of Kaz, and the children of Barzillia, which took a wife of the daughters of Barzillia, the Gileadite, and was called after their name. Verse 62. These sought their register among those that were reckoned by genealogy, but they were not one. Therefore were they as polluted one. Because their names were not registered among those who should come in order or be in the line of the priest. And so when the registry was took up, it said, no, their names are not here. They were put out of the ministry. But Paul comes back and says, listen, this registry that you have in your hand does not designate ministry. Amen. It is that which is called of God. Now, go back in your Bibles to Hebrews. Let's go back to Hebrews chapter 7. Let's jump to chapter 7. All right. We'll come back to chapter 6, but let's move over to chapter 7. And the reason why I'm skipping verse 11 to 14 of chapter 5 is because we dealt with that already in a previous study. And in chapter 6, we dealt with that a little bit too. But we're going to come back and we'll deal with verses 9 to verse 20 in a separate study, okay? But since we've highlighting Melchisedec, I want us to jump right to chapter 7. Are we together? So we're not forgetting about chapter 6, verse 9 down to verse 20. We'll deal with that in another study because we dealing with the two immutable things is something all by itself. And I don't want to confuse you as we deal with Melchisedec. So Christ is called after the order of who? After the order of Melchisedec. And so now when we go to chapter 7, Paul is going to deal with Melchisedec. But let me tell you, Paul is dealing with this subject. But as I said, this is blasphemy. The Jews would have stoned Paul to death if he stood up and did this. They would have beat him out of the sanctuary if he had stood up and presented this subject in the company of Jews. And brothers and sisters, to stand up before God's last day people and show them that God is calling you to ministry, regardless of what school you have gone to, you'll also be beat out of the sanctuary too. Maybe not physically, but they will beat you out of it. But this is what God is calling. This is the ministry that God has given to us in these last days. Notice what it says. Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 1. The Bible says, for this Melchisedec, king of, priest of the Most High God. So Melchisedec was a king and a priest. Jesus is prophet, priest, and king. So Melchisedec better describes the ministry of Christ than that of Aaron. Notice what it says. It says, for this Melchisedec, king of Salem, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. That's in Genesis 14. It says, to whom also Abraham gave a what? Tenth part of all. First being by interpretation, king of righteousness. And after that also, king of Salem, which is king of peace. Without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto one, abideth a priest continually. Now watch this, verse 4. For consider how great this, consider how great this man. Now, again, I'm emphasizing that point because some people often will try to tell you that Melchizedek was not man, was not a man. He was God. But the Bible says he was made, notice verse 5, verse 3, without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, what made like what? Unto the Son of Man abideth what? Son of God, pardon me. Like unto the Son of God abideth a priest how long?
Continually.
Now, we just read in Ezra chapter 2, verse 61 and 62, that coming to the priest, they had a record of what? Record of the priesthood. But when it came to Melchizedek, there was no record. Remember when Jesus came on the scene and he said, this man doesn't have letters. Wait a minute, this man has not gone to our schools. Where did he get this understanding from? He did not sit under our rabbis and get this understanding. Why? Because they had a record of all those who passed through their schools. And therefore, only those who passed through their schools had the authority to minister and preach to the people. Are you with me? But when it comes to Melchizedek, they had no record. In other words, they could not document if he died. They didn't know his mother. They didn't know his father. They didn't know anything about him. And therefore, this is why Paul is saying this man better suits Christ than that of Aaron. Because when it came to the earthly ministry of Aaron, they would often die. Can you imagine? Remember, in the Bible, there were cities called the cities of refuge. Cities of what?
Refuge.
And these refuges were stationed at various parts of the city. The roads were always to be kept clear. And what happened was, when you committed a crime, if it was not premeditated, you would flee to the city of refuge. And as you fled to the city of refuge, anyone seeing you along the way could not hinder you. They could only help you to get to the city of refuge. So they would go to the city of refuge and you would get to the refuge, but you had to be brought before the judges. And if it was determined that the crime was not premeditated, the avenger could not kill you, you would have to stay inside the city of refuge until the high priest died. Once the high priest died, you were permitted to go out and the avenger could not kill you. But the interesting thing is, here you are learning from the high priest and he dies. You have to leave, but now what happens is, in order for someone else to minister your case, they had to go through and they had to get the records all over again. Have you ever been dealing with someone, maybe some legal matters, and your file is passed on to somebody else? And then all of a sudden you go and you got to start all over again, explaining to this person why you did. And they say, well, tell us again. And you just start saying, is it in the computer? Because you don't want to go through the story again. But that's, in a sense, what it was like to have an earthly high priest. Because here they are ministering for you. Another one comes on, but now he doesn't know who you are. You have to, as it were, start all over again, ministering, bringing your case before him. There's no intimate relationship. But with Jesus, guess what? He liveth and abideth forever. And so this is why Paul is showing that the ministry of Christ is much greater than that of Aaron's. Notice what he says. So in verse 3 again, he says, without father, not to say that Melchizedek didn't have a father. He's not saying that he didn't have a mother. He didn't say that he didn't descend from anywhere. But what he's suggesting is showing us is that the Jews had no record of this man. They couldn't keep tabs on him. They couldn't figure out who his mother was and who his father was. But did they know Jesus' father? Jesus says, you don't know from whence I am. They said, you know, God is not, you say, God is not your father. Your father's the devil. God is my father. And so Jesus is showing them that they have no idea who he is, although they know who he is. They said, we know his father. We know his mother. We know his brethren and his sisters. And Jesus saying, you don't know me. So in other words, again, Jesus, even while on earth, is setting the stage like Melchisedec, having neither father nor mother, it says. It says having neither beginning of life or beginning of days. In other words, you don't know when this man was born, but all you know is what the record says about Moses is that he came from Salem. That's all you know about him. And he received tithe of Abraham and he went back and there was nothing else heard of him again.
Right.
Notice what it says. Going on. Verse 4. Now consider how great this man was. He was a man, brothers and sisters, of whom even the what? Patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils. And verily they that are of the sons of Levi, who receive the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of, watch this, verse 6, but he, Melchizedek, whose descent is not counted from them, received tithes of Abraham and blessed him that had the promises. Verse 7. And without contradiction, the what? The less is of the better. Now again, Paul is saying some hard things here to the Jews. And he's showing that, wait a minute, did not Melchizedek bless Abraham? He says, well, we all know, and we don't need to argue this point. We know that the greater generally blesses that which is less. What happened when Jacob came before Pharaoh? Did Pharaoh bless Jacob or did Jacob bless Pharaoh? Jacob blessed Pharaoh. Jacob in that setting was greater than Pharaoh. So when Melchizedek blessed Abraham, it was showing that even his ministry was superior to that of Levi. Watch what it goes on and say. Verse 8, and here men that die receive tithes, but there, watch this, but there he receiveth them of whom it is witnessed that he what? And as I may so say, Levi, now he it's almost like he says it, but he adds this, he adds insult to injury, as it were. And as I may so say, Levi also, who received tithes, paid tithes where? In Abraham. For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. In other words, it's almost like you say this, you need to say it and run. Because he just literally showed now through this encounter with Melchizedek that Abraham, that the ministry of Levi is less than that of Melchizedek.
Amen. That's right.
Through this encounter, through this spiritual confrontation that they had after the slaughter of the kings, he just showed that Abraham acknowledged. Now remember, they said Abraham was their father in John chapter 8. They acknowledged Abraham as being their father. They acknowledged that they came from the loins of Abraham. They acknowledged that in John chapter 8. And Paul comes back and says, guess what? This man was greater than your father, of whom you look so highly to. So constantly Paul is showing, but remember, he's not trying to humiliate the Jews. He's trying to show them that their confidence in these earthly things are useless. that there is something greater. Now watch this. Let's keep in mind what is about to happen in 70 AD. Destruction is coming. Destruction is on the horizon. But he does not just immediately jump out and say, you need to get out of Jerusalem for destruction is coming. He's trying to show them the worthlessness of the position that they're holding. Amen. And that God has a greater calling for them. God has a greater purpose for them than just hovering around in Jerusalem. Being stuck to these earthly traditions and ceremonialism that they're caught up in. And God is trying to move them to greater heights to fulfill the commission that he has brought them to. They don't even realize, brothers and sisters, according to Romans chapter 11, that they have been broken off. They've been broken off from the vine. And Paul is trying to graft them back in again. But they don't even realize it. They see themselves as the chosen of God, and they will always be the chosen of God because they have the Old Testament to prove that God had called them to be the chosen of God when they had forfeited all of the conditions that would have made them the chosen people of God.
Amen. That's right.
And brothers and sisters, we are doing the same today in this generation. We will never be anything else than what God has called us to be. We have all the testimony and the spirit of prophecy to prove it, and yet we're doing everything in our churches and our services and our individual lives that discredit everything that we read in the spirit of prophecy. And we don't even see the condition that we're in today. Notice what it says. Notice what it says in verse 10. If you've just come on with us, please put your phone on mute. Verse 10, it says, for he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchisedec met him. If therefore, watch this, verse 11, if therefore perfection were by the, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should arise after the order of? And not to be called after the order of Aaron. For the priesthood being changed, there is made a necessity, a change also of what? Of the law. Now, brothers and sisters, we need to understand this here. So here he says that there was, he said that if perfection came by the Levitical priesthood, then why would God seek for another? Why would God need another priesthood if perfection can be brought about by the priesthood? So now, what does that tell us when Christ established the ministry of the sacrifices in after the Garden of Eden when they slew the lamb? What was the purpose of the priesthood established for? To bring us where? To bring us where? To Christ, but bring, okay, better question. To bring us to what point?
Perfection.
To bring us to perfection. Because remember, it says if perfection could come by this one, then why would God seek another one?
Amen.
Because the purpose of that, or the purpose of the ministry, is to bring us unto perfection. That's what Jesus intended to do, to bring us to perfection. Notice what it says in Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. We're about to wind this down. Notice what it says. Hebrews chapter 10. Let's look at verse 1. Hebrews chapter 10, looking at verse 1. So the Bible says there also had to be a change of the law. Are we together? There had to be a change of the law, because with the change of the law comes a change. With the change of the priesthood now, there's going to be implemented a new law. Or let me just say, there's going to be implemented a new covenant.
George has left the conference.
Are we together? So there's going to be entered a new covenant. Thank you for your patience and bearing with me in this phone business. Notice what it says in Hebrews chapter 10, but so many people wanted to listen. But we'll have it worked out next week. Notice what it says, Hebrews 10 and verse 1. The Bible says, for the law having a
shadow.
For the law having a
shadow.
Of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those
sacrifices.
Never with those sacrifices which they offer year by year continually make the comers, you and I, thereunto
perfect,
brothers and sisters. So the law, having a shadow of good things to come, can never with those what? Sacrifices. Now, wait a minute. Some would say that, yes, see, look, God changed the law. We don't have to keep the law. But the Bible says this law has what with it?
Sacrifices.
Does the Ten Commandments have sacrifices?
No,
they have no sacrifices. There's no sacrifice with the Ten Commandments. So when it's talking about the change of a law, it's not talking about the change of the Ten Commandments. It is talking about the change of that law, which was implemented by Moses for the purpose of bringing us into harmony with the law of God, which shows us perfection. Are we together?
Yes.
So the change had to come in the law. Now notice something, brothers and sisters. The law, or the ceremonial law, or the covenant that God entered into with his people on Mount Sinai was based upon them saying, all that God has said, we will do. That's what this change had to take place, because they were not able to do all that they said. All that God had desired of them, they could not do it. And now, when they looked at the ceremonial laws, it was with God's intent that they would see that it's Christ that does it, but they could not see Christ in the ceremonial laws. They couldn't see Jesus. Go in your Bible to Micah chapter 6. Micah chapter 6. Have I lost you yet? All right, I didn't hear everybody, so I lost somebody. Notice what it says in Micah chapter 6. Micah chapter 6. I pray that as you go back and look and as you meditate and as you read these scriptures yourself, it'll come clear to you. Because again, Melchisedec was, again, a king and a priest. And this king and priest met Abraham in Genesis chapter 14 as he came back from rescuing the kings of Sodom and the king of Gomorrah. And when he came back, Melchizedek came out and met him, and Abraham gave him tithes of all that he had. And this king blessed Abraham, and he went back to Salem, and Abraham went back into the land of Canaan. And Paul uses this king and priest as a symbol to help us understand the ministry that Jesus is doing now for us in the heavenly sanctuary. And he's showing us that with this ministry comes a new law, comes a new covenant, of which we're going to look at in chapter 8. It comes a new covenant with this new priesthood. So if you thought Aaron's priesthood was good, then this one is better. Why? Because with this one comes better promises. Are we together? There are better promises. And these promises that comes can make us perfect in God's sight. Would you say amen?
Amen.
It can make us perfect. But like we study, you're in Micah chapter 6, but like we studied this past Thursday night, what happens is many of us are still operating under Aaron's law. We're still operating under the old covenant, of the covenant that says all that God has said, we will do. Except the Christ said our promises are like ropes of sand. But when we understand what this new law is and the new covenant is, when we approach Christ, then our confidence will not be in what we can do, but it will be in what Christ can do through us if we would surrender our lives to him. But we're unwilling to surrender. We're unwilling to be led as a child. Why? Because we spent so much of our lives trying to be grown. We don't want to be led like a child. We don't want to be told what to do. We don't really want to be corrected and chastised, as it were. We want to have our own way and be saved in our own good time. And for this reason, we keep saying, all that God has said, I will do. Do we not look back over our week and we see some mistakes that we have made? Amen. Do we not come to the point of saying, you know what? I recognize my faults. Lord, I want to do better than I did last week. Amen. Amen. That is an aspiration that I believe the Spirit of God gives us. But before we make the commitment to do better, we must contemplate, why have I been doing wrong? I'm going to do better. Wait a minute. Well, why am I doing this in the first place? Because an Ethiopian can't change his skin. Neither a leopard his spots. Neither can I do good, because why? I am accustomed, brothers and sisters, to doing evil. I need who?
Christ.
Jesus. I need Jesus. Not just theoretically assenting to saying, yes, I know I need him, but brothers and sisters, the way I pray and the way I study shows my need. If I'm neglecting prayer, if I'm neglecting the searching of the scriptures, then guess what? I am told I will be overcome by Satan's attacks. All whom Satan can lead to neglect prayer and the searching of the scriptures will be overcome by his attacks. So if I'm being overcome by his attacks, it is because I'm neglecting prayer and the searching of the scriptures. Therefore, I don't need Christ. Forget what I stand to. My actions, brothers and sisters, is the table of content of what I really desire. So when we understand the new covenant, yes, we'll stand, but not in our own strength. We'll stand in what God can do for us and not what I can do for myself. And as I learn to depend upon him, then, oh, brothers and sisters, when he points out sin, nevertheless, not my will, let thy will be done. Notice what it says, Micah chapter 6. Micah chapter 6, beginning at verse 6, the people did not understand what the ceremonial law was for. The ceremonial law was to point them to Jesus and to realize that it is not you that can atone for your sin. It is Christ. It says in Micah chapter 6, verse 6, it says, wherewith, notice, this is Micah speaking, wherewith shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God? Before the high God, shall I come before him with what? With calves of a year old. Will the Lord be pleased with what? Or 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my what? Firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the what? So now notice, brothers and sisters, Micah is saying, how do I come before the Lord? Am I to bring these offerings? Am I to gather up all the rams that I can receive? Am I to gather up all these rivers of oil and bring them before the Lord? The oil symbolized the anointing. Amen. I could come before God with all of these professions, but will God be pleased with this? Notice what he says in verse 8. He hath showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee, but to what? And to what? And to walk humbly, what? So God says, listen, Micah is saying, these things is not what God has pleasure in. This is not what God wants to see from us. God wants us to see obedience. God wants us walking with him. And so Micah is understanding, he's trying to tell us, this is not what God desires, but the children of Israel did not understand it. And the priests who had become so corrupt before the Lord had began to make the people believe that this is what God wanted. In the days of Jesus, they would bring a lamb, and the priests were supposed to inspect the lamb. But we are told that the priests would take the lamb, they would inspect it, and they would say, this lamb has blemishes in it, and it cannot be accepted. And they would force the people to buy another lamb at a more exorbitant price. But they would take that lamb and take it in the back, and when someone came in, they would tell them that their lamb was no good, and they would give them the corrupt lamb that they just told the other person was corrupt. This is what they would want, because they were manipulating the superstitious fears that people had about Jesus. And today, the churches are manipulating the superstitious fears that we have concerning God's truth. And they are making people believe that this is where you need to be, even though we are walking opposite of God. Amen. And they are telling people, and they are showing them things in the Word of God, and they say, hey, you can't do this, because if you don't do it, this is what the prophet said is going to happen. And we are fearful of walking in the truth when we know where the truth is.
Amen.
Because of superstition, because we're not reading from the Word of God, or we're reading it with the devil's glasses on, rather than opening the Word of God and seeing what is the truth. Guess what, brothers and sisters? If Jesus and the disciples was here today, they would not be allowed to preach in any of our churches. They would be thrown out of our churches. And I pray to God that they wouldn't be thrown out of this church. But the reality of it is that Jesus would not be accepted in society today. With all the grandeur that people have on Christian churches today, Jesus would not be allowed to take the pulpit in many churches. Why? For fear he say something and their donors stop donating. But that is the reality of then, and that is the reality now. But God is trying to point us to a greater ministry in heaven. There's a greater ministry in heaven other than the ministry that you see in this desk right now. There's something greater, brothers and sisters, than this wooden pulpit. It is the ministry of Christ. And that's who we have to learn to follow. That's who we have to place our eyes upon. As we close, go in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews, chapter 7. Hebrews, chapter 7. Notice what it says, brothers and sisters. Hebrews, chapter 7. You know, I mention this because I get it a lot. And people will listen to some of the sermons. And they would say to me, they say, you know, man, I was really blessed. But Pastor, let me ask you a question. I say, yes. Have you broken away from the Seventh Adventist Church? And I'll pause for a moment. And because generally they would email me or they'd send me a message. Hey, have you broken away from the Seventh Adventist Church? And I'm just about to start writing. And my wife would say, honey, just answer the question. And I say, I'm praying. That's why I'm waiting. Because it's one of these things where I say it's hard for people to differentiate between what is right and what is policy. And we have been so inundated with policies that we are unwilling to accept what is right when it goes against policy. Spirit of Prophecy says a principled person cannot be a policy person. If you're going to follow principles, you cannot follow policy, because policy at some point will conflict with principles, and you have to discern. There's nothing wrong in a sense with a policy, but principles are higher. And they say, have you broken away? And I say, how do you answer that? When someone preaches the truth, you ask them, have they broken away from the church? I say that itself should cause you to think that something is wrong. If you can hear what you believe to be the truth and say, have you broken away from the church? Now, if you hear error, then you say, well, no, 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 no. That ain't part of God's truth. Are we together?
Yeah.
But you can hear truth and say, have you broken away from the church? That should cause you to think. But I said, you know what? I say in some things I could honestly say I have broken away. And I say that in this respect. I say, if the brethren come and say, Pastor Tinsley, we are about to hand out this book called The Great Hope. And there's going to be an initiative and we're going to put thousands of dollars into it and we're going to hand it out. I would say, no, I'm not going to do it. Say, I can, with a good conscience, hand out the book. Now, let's keep this in mind. Have anyone ever heard the book Christ Our Savior? Seen the book Christ Our Savior? Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful little book, but it's an adaptation from Desire of Ages. And it was an adaptation that was written by Edson White. Now, Edson White wrote that adaptation to support his work in the South when he was on the Morning Star. So he got permission from his mother to make an adaptation of Desire of Ages to hand out in the South and to call part of the book around the South to support the Southern work. She gave him permission to do that. So there's nothing wrong with an adaptation. But when the adaptation changes the content of the original, it is no longer an adaptation. It is a separate book. Are we together? But The Great Hope is not an adaptation. It is a change. It is an altered version of The Great Controversy. Because The Great Controversy points out that the papacy is the Antichrist power. That's what The Great Controversy does. The Great Hope says he is not. You go to the website and it says, is the Pope the Antichrist? No. Who is? It's the devil. That's a play on words. Yes. We know the devil is the Antichrist. A minister was asked once, a very prominent minister was asked, will there be a new world order? He talked about heaven. It's a play on words. We know that there's going to be a new world order in the sense of Christ coming. Amen. Yes. But that's not what the question was talking about. The question specifically, will there be a new world order? Not will Jesus come. Will there be a new world order? And they didn't answer the question. Why? Because we're trying to be friendly to apostasy. So in that sense, I would say, no, I can't hand that book out in good conscience. If it was the only thing I had and I was talking to someone and that's the only book I had, I'll give it to somebody. But just to just go out and start handing it out, no, I wouldn't do that. Why? Because it does not teach the truth. They just put out a movie called a movie based off The Great Controversy. They just made a movie, spent over $1 million to make this Hollywood type movie. And they say, this is a good movie. No, it isn't. The movie goes totally against the book Great Controversy. It is a distorted view of what the book says. So in that sense, I cannot and I will not support it or stand behind it. So, brothers and sisters, we have to understand, we have to know what is truth. We're told in Desire of Ages that Jesus did not even pretend to be in harmony with the teachings of the Pharisees. Amen. He didn't even give just allude to the fact that he's in harmony with them. She said in Desire of Ages that the disciples did not understand why Jesus did not try to work with the Pharisees, for they felt that his cause would have greater advantage with the people if he just tried to work with the Pharisees. But Jesus knew that that would distort his work. Desire of Ages, under the chapter, he trained the training of the 12. So I'm saying, brothers and sisters, this is where we are. So a person can literally hear the truth and ask, are you a part of the church? I thought we were called to preach the truth. So why would you hear a person preaching the truth and then say, are they a part of the church? If they were preaching error, you would say, can I ask you some questions? But not if they're preaching the truth, brothers and sisters. Yes. But that's what the devil has done. He has flipped it. And made us think that to hear the truth, something is wrong with it. And that's where Paul was when he was dealing with Melchisedec. He was exhorting the truth, but he was being cast out as a heretic. Martin Luther was preaching the truth, cast out as a heretic. And you and I, in these last days, you have people who are standing up for the Constitution, but guess what society is saying? They're crazy.
Terrorists.
They're terrorists. They're extremists. Look at these people. Something's wrong with them. Always talking about the Constitution. They're crazy. Always come. But remember, the devil has just flipped it. He has just changed the narrative. And so now, when you mention the Constitution, it's like, oh, here they go, these Looney Tunes. That's what they have been painted as, Looney Tunes. Why? For the whole purpose, brothers and sisters, of bringing on the New World Order. That's what his intent was. And then when it comes to the Bible, those who exalt the truth, they're extremists. Says in Second Selected Messages, she says, when Seventh Adventists start living the truth that we profess to believe, we will be looked at as odd, singular, straight-laced extremists. When we start living in harmony with the truth of the Word of God, we're going to be called singular, meaning that, hey, you think you're better than everyone and you just want to be by yourself. No. Straight-laced. Hey, everything has to be done this way. And you're extreme. Or in other words, you're fanatical. When we start living, who's going to be calling us that? Not the world. We have more to fear from within than we do from without. It was one of Jesus' own that led him, that led the soldiers to him. So here we are again. This is what Paul was actually doing. And brothers and sisters, like I said, this was blasphemy when Paul preached it. And guess what? It is no more accepted today. Evangelicals, oh, they talk about Jesus and the love of Christ. And you start showing them the truth of God and they'll start acting like the devil. What happened to the love of Jesus? Then they believe in the Old Testament. Then they want to lay hands on you. Notice what it says. We're closing here. We're going to close this. Notice Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 7. The Bible says, verse 12 again, it says, for the priesthood being what? There is made a necessity, a change also of the law. Ten commandment law?
No.
The ceremonial law, according to Hebrews chapter 10. For he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to what? Of which no man gave attendance at the altar. Verse 14, this is where we close and we pick up the next time on verse 15. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of
Judah,
of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning what? Nothing concerning, meaning that Jesus, his ministry was not after the common order of things. Not after the common order. Guess what? Those who are called in these last days will be out of the common order of things.
Amen.
They will not attend our seminaries. There are still some people, brothers and sisters, that are holding on to the light they know. But I was told by a seminary professor himself, when they said, hey, you know, he said, hey, this young man is preaching. He said, oh, so I'll see you at the seminary. And I said, no, you won't see me there. And he said, why? I said, well, I don't believe I need to come. And he said, you know, I agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
He said, because the people that we're sending out of our seminaries, they don't know anything. And I'm sitting there and I just kind of under the table grab my wife's hand and, you hear what this man's saying? And he just started going on about the people that they're sending out of their seminaries. They don't know anything. Seminary teachers are looking at these pastors and says, hey, I know what you've been taught over there in some of your colleges, but this idea that you can be perfect, you need to get that out your head. You need to throw away your Ellen White books. Get all that stuff out of your head because we're going to deal with you. And this is why I've met pastors who believe one thing, go through the seminary on the other side, and you would think that they were an infidel. Because this is the seminary, they all on one accord, teaching this ecumenical doctrine. But those who are called by God in these last days will be called after the common order of things. They will be studying the Word of God, and all of a sudden the Spirit of God will move upon them, and they will be able to put line upon line, precept upon precept, and they will go forth in the strength of God, preaching God's truth. And we'll say, hey, how's that man having letters having never learned? In other words, who gave him the authority to preach that truth? That's in our vaults. Where'd you get that information from? I got it from the Word of God. But this is where Paul was, and this is where God is calling us. But we have to come in line with that new law, that new covenant. That new covenant of grace that works upon the heart, that works from the inside out. That causes us to have complete dependence on Jesus Christ. Where we love to pray, brothers and sisters, in the evening, in the morning, and at noon, brothers and sisters. Where we learn to meditate upon God's law day and night, brothers and sisters. Where we will find the Word of God and we will eat it, and it will be the joy and the rejoicing of our hearts. That's the experience that God wants to give to us. That's the experience that the Holy Spirit is longing to give to us. God is not waiting for the Sunday law. God is not waiting for these things to take place. And brothers and sisters, if you look at Great Controversy has set up these last day scenes perfectly. While they're trying to get their finances right, all of a sudden storms and earthquakes and floods are breaking out all over the place. They have no control over it. And their final solution, we better get back to God. That's right. We better get our hands back in His hands. And all it takes, brothers and sisters, is one of our religious leaders to have a quote unquote Constantine moment. And they look and say, you know what? We can unite our nation if we just kind of bring it all together. We could just bring it all together. All they got to do is have that epiphany. And next thing you know, they're going to call for the people to come together and to unite and pray to God to restore to us temporal prosperity. That is what they're going to be calling for. Right now, everyone can care less because everyone is living for themselves. Something major has to happen. Something that was greater than what happened in 2008 when the stock market fell. Something greater than that has to happen. Because guess what? Whether the stock market goes bad or good, there's a certain group of people that's making money regardless. There's people that's making money even when the stock market go bad. Goldman Sachs already confessed to it. When the housing market went bad, they made billions afterwards. Here you in a recession, and Bill Gates has gone from $50 billion to $72 billion. These men, Buffett gave away $30 billion and got it all back. So regardless of what it looks like, they're still making money. But something has to happen where there is an extreme call to get us back to temporal prosperity. And the stage is being set. And guess what? God is in His love and His mercy trying to get our minds off of earth back to heaven. He is trying to get us in a position, brothers and sisters, where we learn how to care more about the gospel than about what we eat or what we put on. He's trying to get us to be like those lilies, those ravens, those birds that take no thought. They don't have no barns. They're not doing all this, but yet their Father is feeding them. Amen. The lilies, brothers and sisters, who don't toil or spin, but are more arrayed than Solomon in all his glory. God is trying to get us back to that type of simple life. And He's trying desperately to do it. And brothers and sisters, we have to get on one accord with God. But we have to get this in our hearts. We have to get this in our hearts. Some people say you need to be in a country, and I do believe that. But brothers and sisters, you know when Y2K happened, people ran to the country. And they bought land, and they put houses on it. You know what those people are today? Those people got bigger houses here in the city. And guess what? They are determined they are never going back out there again. Because they ran, brothers and sisters, ahead of the time. They were not walking with God. They were moving with fear. Get our hearts back in God's hands, brothers and sisters. People are on more prescription drugs than ever before. They're on depressants. They're on all sorts of things. And brothers and sisters, we're walking around as if life is just going to be around tomorrow, and people are losing it because they see no way out from the troubles they're in. But God has given us a solution. God has given us a solution. Father in heaven.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure. That He would give His only Son. To make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns His face away as wounds that mar the chosen.